Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending, of course, when you're viewing us. Welcome to Around Town with Dave Walsh, and I am your host, David Walsh. Our show covers the great events and happenings in the town of Stoughton and the people who make those happenings happen. Today, I have with us Superintendent of Stoughton Public Schools, Dr. Joe Baeta, to my left here, and I'd like to welcome him to the show. He's a guest who's been with us before, so he's not going to go through the whole introduction of himself, but great to have you here.
Great to be back.
Great.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, great. I appreciate you coming. I know you're on a busy schedule. And
it's that time of year.
Yeah. Well, I saw you yesterday, too. Yesterday, we had the Frederick Richard event at the high school, which was well-attended and a well-event. It was just...
Yeah, it's just one of those things. Anytime, first of all, in my field, anytime you can celebrate kids, that's a great thing.
Right? Right,
kids, staff, our families. But the sense of community in the room yesterday was...
You could feel it.
You could feel it. You could feel that everybody just... of different backgrounds, different perspectives and views, just dropped everything and said, we need to celebrate our Olympian, right? Just saying that makes you think, wow, we have an Olympian in Stoughton,
right,
which is not something that every community can say.
Absolutely.
And well attended, great proclamations on his behalf. I wasn't here when Fred was a student, but I've heard great things. And then the celebration continued at the Boston Garden.
But you're a resident of Stoughton still when
I
was there.
Yes, I was still a resident of Stoughton, still matters. Right. And then the celebration culminated with Stoughton residents and members of my staff being at the garden.
Wow.
And Deborah Roberts, who really has to be given a lot of kudos for putting this together. And Christina Acabucci, who did a great job in the background, but just really organizing it all email after email. And really being there for everybody. And then everybody in the background that was really involved in making sure the day was a great day for Frederick and his family and friends, right?
Yes.
And that's what the audience consisted of.
Yeah. No, it was very well done. I agree. And her organization, you know, pulling a group together to be able to organize that was well done. So I agree. I think we all appreciate it.
Not everybody gets a key to the city, as we say, right?
Exactly.
To the town.
And gets the big belt.
Gets the big belt.
Okay, moving on for another subject, I wanted to see if you wanted to discuss the, I know there was some awards that were given from the secondary, Department of Secondary Education recognizing Stoughton High School.
So we you know, there's a lot of great things happening in Stoughton, and I think one of the things we have to do a better job is really getting that out there. So Stoughton High School was recognized by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education for its outcomes on MCAS this year. For its significant growth overall, but really the targeted growth of improving our lowest performing students. The calculation for MCAS is grounded on the improvement of that subgroup. So you're looking at your low income, your special education, your ELL, MLL population, et cetera. And you're looking to see where you are, where you were, which remember it's different kids, and that's part of the formula problem, is the different groups of kids every year, but still, we saw tremendous growth, such a big growth that you know, we're saying to ourselves, how did this happen? How was it so great? Well, I think it has to do with organizational structure and systems. It has to do with outstanding educators in the classroom really targeting these students. You know, we've seen great decrease in discipline issues and behavioral issues in the last 24 months at the high school. We've reorganized the schedule this year where we think it's even going to be better. So when you take all of that, it's another sense of that school community and all involved in that school community really, really targeting teaching and learning, as I say, curriculum instruction and student performance. So kudos to the entire high school, its leader, Principal Julie Miller, her team, and then, of course, every teacher that's involved with every student at the high school that was involved in this assessment. It's one test, as I always say. You know, I can't say that I'm the biggest proponent of one test as a reason to celebrate. But this distinguished us as one of the better high schools in the nation. We didn't meet the blue ribbon notification yet, but we'll get there. But then I can also tell you that in the last few hours, I've received notification that we are being recognized by the College Board Advanced Placement Scores.
Oh, wow.
We haven't even publicized that yet.
Oh, breaking news.
Breaking news.
Breaking news on the show.
You're the first to have it.
Great.
It'll be going out sometime today, but we've just been recognized as a bronze school for our excellent accomplishments on number of students not only participating, but their actual outcomes.
Oh, good.
So once again, a first for us where we're really climbing those scores in a positive way. And kudos to the graduating class who were part of that and the juniors, predominantly now the senior class. Those are the two groups of students that predominantly participate in AP classes. But not every school in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts is being recognized for both of those.
Yeah.
Two very different assessments, an MCAS and an AP, taught differently. The outcomes are different. They mean something. You know, you got a graduation requirement with the MCAS required, plus right. your local. You got AP. I can tell you from having a family member, my own daughter, not having to take certain classes in college next year, this outcome means that a lot of our students who continued on got a lot of those accolades as entering freshmen this year, which is great, and plus our juniors that will be that are currently seniors. So kudos. Great 1-2 punch.
Yeah, I'll say it. And that MCAS award, right? I mean, that was like one of 14 schools?
Yeah, so that so what they do is we had 14 high schools throughout the entire state that were recognized. There's a list that, that there's a lot of schools that improved, and it depends on your grade span and so on. Ours was targeted towards our high school and mm-hmm. our high school results. We have some more work to do in our 3-8 area of testing, and we're actually currently meeting about how to do that. We'll be releasing through an actual report with the school committee and then the public probably late October, early November. You want to get it right when you're reporting this stuff in terms of what were our strengths and what are our opportunities. And clearly we have some opportunities, especially now that we have for 2026, at least 90% of third graders at the end of third grade reading at grade level. That's a goal that no one around us has.
Yeah.
So, but you can't, as the superintendent, announce, hey, I just want 50% of my kids reading.
Right.
You got to go for something.
Yeah.
So we're going for something, and we hope to see those improvements. And we began to see improvements in certain grade levels of both the elementary and middle school level, but they're not there yet.
Okay. That's interesting. I mean, I know there's even a ballot question coming up.
Yeah, there is a ballot question coming up. I get cornered about that one all the time. I think the ballot question there's a lot of frustration around this. And the frustration level is that, since the class of 2003, so 2003 was the first class who had to pass the test. They didn't even have to make minimal scores. The cut score in those days was English and math only at 220. Mm-hmm. That's what you needed.
Right.
You got a 220, you were done. There was, and here we are in 2024, and we still, we moved to, quote, the next generation test. Well, we moved to computerized testing in 2018, 2019. I'm not sure that that's, 19 years into the 21st century. I'm not sure that that's really what we were talking about. We were talking about what are other domains and ways of really taking a look at how students are assessed and showing what they can or can't do. We have students who have to show progress within their educational, in this case, an educational plan, an individual education plan. It's about progress and making those goals. And yet we have this one test. And so the frustration level is there. It hasn't been handled at the legislative level. DESE is doing its thing. There is a mandate for testing from the feds. You have to test.
Of some form.
Of some form.
Okay.
Locally, we have it as a graduation requirement in Massachusetts, and there's really no outs except for an appeal process, and that's very difficult to get because so many things have to add up for that to happen. That said, we do pretty well in Stoughton, so in terms of Stoughton, it's a little different versus some of the areas that I think have more of a struggle with kids passing the test and getting to graduation. But it's also not the future. Testing and how we're currently doing it is clearly not the future. And you look at higher education and what our kids are doing today and the graduates are doing today, right? It's all about the people skills. It's all about presentations. Yeah. It's all about working collaboratively.
For sure.
It's all about being that critical thinker and critical writer, that outside the box thinking.
And we have a challenge with that. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but with the challenge now, with the electronics and
You have the novices and then you have the kids who, literally are born with it, right?
Right.
And those of us that I'm still trying to catch up at 55 to all this other stuff. And every day things change, never mind social media, just everything that's in front of you changes. So I think it's a question out of a lot of frustration. It's a ballot led by the teachers, the Mass Teachers Association. And I think there's going to be a lot of difficult discussions as people walk into the ballot box and say, what am I really going to do with this?
Right.
And some of it is personal. My kids struggled or I struggled and, made it, but had to do so many other things that created so many other negative aspects of anxiety. And then at the same time, accountability is important.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what we've recognized in the last 20 or 30 years is that accountability is important and the taxpayers want to see accountability.
Right.
The question is, if I gave my teachers if I told my teachers they can only give multiple choice tests or fill in the blank or a short answer response, I would say to them that they're not a good teacher.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because we have to have as many different types of assessments. But long-winded, I think it's going to be a very controversial ballot question.
Right. Okay. And thank you. I appreciate that insight on it. I kind of took you by surprise on that one. But,
sure.
Redistricting. Huh. So I don't know if you've
MCAS might be easier than trust.
Understand. And this must be so many iterations of the redistricting plan that's being looked at based on what's, you know.
Yeah,
what's
so we're just starting to put together the redistricting committee. I just asked, redistricting also goes along with potentially modular classrooms. So we have two redistricting concepts. One, a question gets put on the ballot for April and actually is successful, and we're building a new school and we're redistricting. And then you've got plan B. It doesn't go on the ballot or it loses at the ballot and we're still redistricting because the intent is we're closing the South School. Mm-hmm. And the idea behind that would be to then look at where do permanent modular classrooms go. And there's a lot of questions there. You know, you got sewer connections, you got transportation costs, you got where do they get built, you've got legal questions around fire protection and ADA. You know, is it considered an extension of the school or is it just being attached to the school? Sewer connection, are the piping big enough for it? Questions that I'm not an expert in any way, but in doing new buildings, I know we've had to address that.
Sure.
So when you're doing a renovation addition, which I did in my last district to a high school, is this an addition or is it just an add-on? Is it temporary? Is it permanent? And the cost is still in the millions, millions. And I'm not sure that you can just take 300 students and move them to only the Daw and the Gibbons. I think we also have to take a look at potentially the Hanson or the Wilkins. All of those are in play. If the ballot question gets put on there and passes, then we're looking at redistricting with a new school and then the closing of the South School and the reorganization, restructuring of the Wilkins becoming a pre-K or a preschool, potentially the administration moving there. And then what comes next is the Jones School and what to do with that, which would probably be more than likely a teardown as well. At least the one section of it would be a complete teardown.
And the South School then won't be?
The South School would be off. Okay. That would be gone too. The biggest debate I think that happens that was difficult is when the project was put together, MSBA outright said, we're not paying for a demolition because you're not on the same site. You're on a different site. So then the discussion became, what do we do? And one of the things that was thought of, and I came in later into this, but potentially there is contingency in this project. Could the contingency then be swayed to be moved into just tearing down the building? In the same way that when we did the high school project, it came in under, and funds were utilized for the purposes of the administration and so on and so forth. So when you look at all of this, there's all of that. And then there's just a hard no. It doesn't matter if I'm building a cubicle, a large elementary school, we're voting no matter what. Mm. And it's unfortunate because we are going to get ourselves into a predicament in Stoughton where do we send these students if, in fact, the building is not appropriate. And I wasn't here for what to do with the school, and a decision was made to then go with the high school project. And I'm not at all Monday morning quarterback that decision. I think that was the right decision. I supported it. I think the issue that we have before us is another no vote or costs of modulars, which, quote, are permanent versus temporary, regardless of any of that, we got a big monster to address, and that's the middle school.
Yeah.
And so by saying no in June, if that no becomes a further no, we are going to be spending millions upon millions of dollars, including potentially debt exclusion for the or borrowing for the purposes of the middle school, because that's a Band-Aid that's been happening there for quite a while as well, and that's a growing student population down there.
Yeah. So you're saying if the no vote happens, then you know the MSBA is not going to be interested in supporting us in the middle school.
I don't see that. It's hard. It's hard to explain leaving 42 cents on the dollar of funds from the state on what you know is allowed back. It's hard to say why that doesn't play some more favor with folks. But closing a school, redistricting, the cost of the school, those are all very individually based questions. We know by just looking at the voting that certain populations of our parents did not vote.
Right.
Certain populations even voted no. And it has to do a lot with I don't necessarily want to move from my small neighborhood school that I walk my kid to school today.
Right.
Versus putting them on the bus, and I'm not even sure that my child is going to see the benefit of the South school mm-hmm. that I'm paying for.
Because right.
they could be redistricting, going to another school.
You know.
So it's one of those situations, and I think that we have to make it more of a straightforward if-then situation for the taxpayers. Without doing that, then I think we're in another situation of either a very close vote or people just not really caring. And what that does is do exactly what I think I can say this as a resident, which is to kick the can. And now the can just became a lot more expensive.
Yeah.
And you know, we're dealing with some of that in Stoughton as we're building a fire station right now that we should have built many years ago, but it was kicked down the can.
Yeah, and if I understand, there was a petition put out with the signatures to get the question. So does it have to go to the selectmen, or is that enough to say it's getting onto the town meeting?
Selectmen supported putting it on the warrant for the town meeting, but they didn't have to. It's a citizen's petition in town by regulation goes straight to town meeting.
It had enough signatures.
It had over 1,100.
Yeah, and I think it's in the hundreds you need, and I think I've had over 1,000.
So that was the hard part. I think the next part will be, how does town meeting feel about it? And then coming out of that, is it put on the ballot? Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of...
So if it goes to town meeting coming up, then if they vote yes, then it goes on the ballot for April. If they vote no, it doesn't go.
Right. So the select board still have the right to put it on the ballot, is my understanding.
Oh,
so,
even if they get a no vote.
Right.
Town meeting.
So typically, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's the process we used last time, is that we went to town meeting, and then after town meeting, the select board voted to put it on the ballot.
Oh, okay.
So we have elected officials who may have voted yes at town meeting as a town meeting rep to move it forward. Yes, as an elected official to move it forward, and then potentially no at the ballot box. That could happen.
Sure.
Or vice versa. You know, said I have some worries, but then said, you know what? What the heck? I'm going to vote yes for it anyways. And those are individual decisions that our elected officials make as private citizens.
So right now you've got like two redistricting plans you're trying to sort out, but you won't really know how this whole thing sorts out until after.
Yeah, our first meeting will be in November. We're getting parents to come out, might do some community members. There'll be some surveying, all that. They'll have an organizational meeting. Julie Miller, the principal of Stoughton High School, will chair that committee, and then they'll elect from within a vice chair as well. And these meetings will be public. There will be an agenda. There will be minutes. It can be covered, by whoever. So probably it's going to be a big committee. That large committee will then break out into subcommittees. So you'll have subcommittees that are looking at potentially by the springtime A or B plan, C plan. Do we change our model of schools? That actually came up today. Do we say we're no longer K to fives? We're going to look at becoming pre-K to twos or K to twos and three to fives.
Oh, okay.
All of that can be discussed.
Sure.
And then the school committee will post a number once it has its options, which should be easy, probably a good 14, 16 months away. They would then go through the process of having all of that information vetted. Public hearings would take place, and then they get to make that final decision as a school committee.
So the schedule, putting a timeline together, has got to be somewhat complicated because you're looking at a bunch of variables moving here. So
the variables are a lot. We're going to have to hire a third party, which takes a look at, you know, where are kids right now? Where are kids going to be in 2 years, 3 years? Does it impact them or not? What's the churn? You know, we're churning about 12% of our kids a year. So, you know, 10% is about 380. So we're over 400 students in and out of the district on a regular basis. That means a lot when you're looking at K to five
districts. Exactly. Right.
I mean, that's 400 kids that could be swayed.
Talking about a variable, right?
Yeah, even if it's 108 of those 400 kids that are changing, that's a huge variable. And the last part is, don't forget, we're going to have to review ourselves under what OCR would want us to look at. So demographics, socioeconomics, you can't set up a school that's, you know, going to be predominantly your EL population. We already have some of that in Stoughton. But in this case, we're choosing to redistrict. As we do so, we're going to have to meet some of those guidelines and really take a look at socioeconomics, other demographics. And for us, it also means things like transportation. Because if you're eliminating an entire side of town and moving to modulars, let's say, and let's say it's modulars at two other buildings or three other buildings or four other buildings, your transportation now is, you're no longer like this. You're no longer a neighborhood district. You're like this.
Right.
You know, so it could have a lot of impacts on families.
Yeah. And they, from a timeline perspective, so you've mentioned November is the kind of
Yeah, so November of this year, the committee will kick off. That's our goal. I'll be attending that meeting, and then I become ex officio. The report will be coming to me. And then from there, my office will set up separate meetings and presentations and all of that, send it back to them for more questions and answers, and then get the final report written. So right now, if we were redistricting with modular classrooms, let's say, and closing the South School, not knowing what those modulars would be, but knowing that we have 307 kids in that building right now, you can't just move 150 into one and 150 into another. There's all kinds of complications with that.
Yeah.
But to that end, whatever that number would be, how many schools would be affected, you're looking at the earliest, it would be at the earliest, and that would depend on are you borrowing through town meeting or debt exclusion or both for the purposes of that. Because remember, you still got to design this thing.
Right, right.
You know, people just think you're just going to bring a couple of modulars right. in and plant it and you're done.
You have to design the engineering that goes yeah, into figuring
yeah,
that out.
Yeah, so sewer connections, right? One of the things that happened at the middle school years ago is that we ended up having to put a tank, septic tank, in when we added the modulars. And part of that was because part of the sewer system in that building goes under the building. So, you know, you have all kind of, or in some cases, too long of a loop to get to the sewer connection from the back of the school.
Yeah.
So you have to take a look at all of those things. So you still need a site design. You still need to pull permits. You still got to go through conservation, you know, all of that stuff, and plan approved. So, you know, that's less than a year in the making. But then depending on how many schools are affected, that could be an entire year to 2 years before you're actually in the building.
Wow.
Depending on how complicated it becomes.
Yeah, so I mean, just all that put together, again, it's this big schedule of how all this integrated schedule is going to work to be able to make the deadlines.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why we want to do the subgroups, to really take a look at different things, let a smaller group go and get the information, bring it back to the whole group. Bring in the experts in the field, get public input. I think that's a really important part. You know, one of the things that's come out of this situation of adding a South School Working Group committee has been folks, quote, not having the information. We didn't do, and I'll speak for myself on the building committee, not doing a good enough job of telling the public about it. The fact of the matter is all the information is on the website, and all the information and all the meetings were taped and so on and so forth. But we needed to do a better job of getting things out there than we did, and I think that's one of the things the working group is working on, is to really take a look. I've presented to them twice about where the information is. Now I'm going back and giving them even further detail of where the information is. And hope to have that to them.
Yeah. So just to be clear. So that's the working group, and then there's the building committee. They're two.
Right. Two separates.
So you can shake hands full trying to keep both.
Yeah. Well, I'm an invited guest to the South Shore, to the South School Working Group. I went there as a person of the know and gave them the information, so they could have exactly what's on our website, what was discussed at building meetings, the minutes, the agendas, the handouts, the thousands upon thousands of pieces of paper that are available, and try to cut that down to more of a summation of information for them to have and then decide how they're going to use it. Mm-hmm. The building committee has not changed its assignment. Its assignment is to build a new South School as presented. They're looking right now at maybe a couple of dollars here that can be saved. But remember, MSBA has already noted, first, hardly ever do they do this, extend somebody yet so much almost a year later.
Yeah.
Two, MSBA has said you cannot touch the educational plan. You touch the educational plan, we're pulling you out.
Because
it's another plan.
Right.
And they want to make sure that the plan that we at the local level said is what we wanted, was approved, was sanctioned by the school committee, approved by the school committee and the building committee. Tons of hours and time put into collecting the data from parents, students, staff. This is the plan. If you change that plan, modify that plan outside the scope of what we think, MSBA thinks, we're pulling this.
Right.
And we're going to spend our time with someone else, which means we go back to the end of the line.
Yeah. Or hopefully stay in the line.
Hopefully stay in the line.
So I guess the working group's going to have some results based on the data that they got that's going to come forward to give their results.
Yeah, I think their job is to say, here's the information. as presented at all of those meetings. Here's it is black and white. We have no recommendation. That is not their job.
Right.
They're not there. They're just there to say, here it is in black and white. And now give it to everybody who wants to read it and dive into it. And does that change your activism, your decision, your vote?
Do you know if they're still on schedule for the November? It's kind of
my understanding that they're trying to get on, stay on schedule for November. The tight schedule.
Yeah, I know. And I was hoping that when their results come out, that we'll be able to present that as part of the Roundtown show as well to get the results out there. And some, because I think what happens, you get this large voluminous data, and it's hard to go through, and not everybody has the time to go through that type of data. In fact, I think you and I talked. I put it on the table. Is, you know, one of the things I've seen on social media is nobody knows, you know, what the South School looks like inside, because they aren't.
Yeah.
So I've offered to, you know, and you're totally on board, which is great, of doing a tour of the school, just to, you know, I just want to do a factual, picturesque view of what the school looks like, so that, you know, people can see what that, you know, what the school looks like, right?
Yeah,
so.
I mean, our commitment is to, my commitment is to get facts out. Mm-hmm. And in my role, it's just about facts. I have my own personal opinions. I'm also a voter in town because I reside. I'm a first time that's ever happened to me, so it's kind of an interesting thing. But my job is to present facts and information. Other people are going to sway that information the way that they want, because that's what the political world looks like today.
Right.
But
and I'm in the same picture. My thing is I just want to get the facts out there. I want
to
inform the public of what's going on, and because there's a lot of good stuff going on, and just want to make sure people are aware of it. And speaking of that, as we're winding down, I wanted to get, I understand there's a unified basketball team, and which is a great news story, so I just want to get that out there.
So without getting into names and information, everybody involved, let me just say from one thing. So one of the proudest things that I had in my last district was unified basketball, unified sports. We played bocce at the middle school.
Ah.
I mean, it was just, and we had track. Two things. Number one, it's all about all students, regardless of our abilities and our challenges. Number two, what it does for our special education students is incredible. The sense of team, the sense of being able to be part of that team, to be active in that team. And I think as important is teaching the rest of the school community how important it is to be accepting of others, regardless of their physical abilities, academic abilities, social abilities. It's all about that. And so Stoughton High School has done an awesome job. And we got the pep band there. We got the kids staying after school. The captains and the coaches are going to practice later to make sure that the kids are there, just to give them a sense of pride. Yeah. And as a person who attends them, I can tell you it gives you a lot of pride. It really does.
Yeah.
So it's all involved. Kudos to doing it. And most importantly, to our families who have really said, yes, we want our kids involved with this, regardless if they're our helper and a best buddy, or if they're the student themselves that's participating.
That's really good. That's really good data, because I mean that's a good news story, and it's real heartwarming to be able to.
You can't get any better.
Yeah, I agree. So as we're winding down the time, I really appreciate you coming over and giving me an update and the latest going on, and keeping our folks informed of, you know, how well things are going at the school. And
it's a great school system. We just ask our parents to participate.
Excellent. I like it. So thanks again for coming over. I thank you viewers for tuning in to watching us. I'd also like to thank the folks working in the back here at SMAC, Anya, Luke, Caroline, and Chris, for doing all the behind scenes, because if we didn't do what they do, we wouldn't have a show. So I appreciate that. So this is Dave Walsh wishing you all a great day. And until next time, see you around town.